Let's begin with the prayer. This is St. Thomas Aquinas' prayer before study. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Creator of all things, true source of light and wisdom, lofty origin of all being, graciously let a ray of your brilliance penetrate into the darkness of my understanding, and take from me the double darkness in which I have been born, an obscurity of both sin and ignorance. Give me a sharp sense of understanding, a retentive memory, and the ability to grasp things correctly and fundamentally. Grant me the talent of being exact in my explanations, and the ability to express myself with thoroughness and charm. Point out the beginning, direct the progress, and help in completion through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, well, where we left off a year ago, we will have a little bit of a review to begin with, and if you would like me to print off additional copies of last year's, the first three sections that we made it through, I can do that, but we're essentially going to pick up where we left off. We covered the first five books of the Bible, as well as, in addition to those, we did an overview of the Old Testament and kind of how to read Scripture. So the structure of this year's classes, we're going to, tonight, we're going to do that review, like I just said, and we will begin talking about the Kingdom of Israel. As the Israelites enter into the Promised Land, how that all occurs. And then we may or may not finish both of those tonight. We'll see. I'm not going to keep you longer than the time that I said ahead of time. The next topic will be the end of the Kingdom of Israel, which happened rather quickly after the beginning of it. The return to Israel after the exile. I'll explain what all this really means. And that will wrap up the Old Testament. From there, we will go on to the New Testament. So we will have an entire class about the world that Jesus lived in, what things were like, where he lived, and when he lived. We will talk about the life of Jesus himself. And then finally, we will talk about the early church in the letters and the Acts of the Apostles of the New Testament. So I got to keep an eye on this because it stops after every 30 minutes, but all right. Reviewing from last year, you'll remember maybe that we started out with how to read the Bible. And I pointed out that it's important to understand that the Bible is literature, meaning that it was written by people in a certain time in a certain place. And it's not only literature, but it's ancient literature. We read Shakespeare and kind of scratch our heads, and that's in English, and it was only 500 years ago. The scriptures, the most recent ones, were nearly 2,000 years ago, and they were not written in English. They were written in Hebrew and Greek. And so we have to keep in mind that there's a lot of time in between us and them, and there's a lot of translation in between us and them. And so because of that, the scriptures aren't always easy to understand. I gave you the example of Song of Songs, chapter 4, where this guy is professing his love to this woman, and he's describing her teeth as sheep, and her hair as a flock of goats, and her neck as a Tower of David with shields hanging upon it, and how that would not fly in today's world. That would not be very flattering for a woman. But anyways, that would have been back then. So we have to keep that in mind, that the human author lived in a definite time and place. We have to approach Scripture from that way. And because of that, there's really two ways of reading Scripture. And the first is what we call the literal sense. And that's the intention of the human author and what he wanted to express. So in Song of Songs, he's writing a love poem, for example. And then there is the spiritual sense of reading Scripture, which is the additional meaning that the Holy Spirit adds to it. So it is, yes, it's a love poem, and it should be read from that perspective, but then we can add layers onto it because it's part of the Bible. We know that it is a love poem written from God to us, and so it takes on a lot more meaning that way. And so there's many layers to basically every verse of the Bible. I also talked a lot about typology. A type is a person that, or an event in Scripture that foreshadows another person or event in Scripture. We looked at, for example, when Abraham goes to sacrifice Isaac. There's a lot of similarities between that story and the story of the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. We looked at the story of Joseph and how his betrayal by his brothers led to the salvation of God's chosen people, saving them from famine. Just like Jesus, who was betrayed by one of his brothers, Judas, that led to the salvation of the whole human race. So there's parallels, and that's the reason why we have the Old Testament, is to, they are all connected to Christ. They're all fulfilled in Jesus. So when we're reading the Bible, it's good to look to the church for guidance. There can be a million different ways to interpret a verse of the Bible, so how do you know what we should and shouldn't think about it? There's a certain amount that we can do on our own, obviously in our own personal prayer, but if we have a question about what this actually means, we can go to the church. You can ask a priest, you can look up that verse up in the catechism, things like that. What to read first? I said the Gospels probably is the best place to start. The Gospel of Luke is a good one for beginners because it was written for Gentiles, for people who were not Jewish. So it doesn't include a lot of Jewish terms and phrases that you would have to know ahead of time in order to get a grasp on what the author is talking about. Genesis and Exodus are also good. We covered those last Lent, last year, because they kind of give us the background for the entire story. Also, we have to keep in mind that Scripture is God's words to us, so we need to pray before we kind of dive into Scripture. It's good to pray to the Holy Spirit for guidance. And if you make prayer, if you make praying with the Scriptures a daily part of your life, then they will mean a lot more to you than they otherwise would. Also, the Scriptures are a major part of the Mass, so pay attention to the Mass and the readings that are used at Mass, and maybe look into why they're used at that particular Mass. All of the promises contained in Scripture are fulfilled in Jesus, and Jesus is made present to us on the altar at the Mass. Then we talked about divine revelation. And divine revelation, of course, has its origin in God. Divine revelation is God revealing himself to us. And this happens first through the patriarchs and the prophets of the Old Testament, which we talked about the patriarchs last year. We'll kind of brush over them. And then his revelation is completed in Jesus. He brings it to fulfillment. Jesus chooses 12 men to be his apostles, and he told them to teach God's revelation to all people. The Holy Spirit guides the apostles and the early church, and all the way down to the time that we live in, to faithfully hand on all that Jesus revealed. This teaching was passed on in two ways. You had the oral form and the scriptural form. In the early church, it was mostly the oral form, and most people were not literate, so they passed on the teaching by word of mouth. And then finally, bringing it all the way to us, the apostles left bishops as their successors, and they gave them the authority to teach in their place, and the Pope, united with the bishops, is what we call the magisterium, which is a fancy word we give to the teaching authority that the church has to authentically interpret God's revelation. And then we receive it. So because of that process and how the Word of God comes to us, how revelation comes to us, we say that there are three parts of revelation. There is tradition, there is the magisterium, and then there is Scripture itself. So we have the unwritten Word of God, the written Word of God, and the authoritative interpreter of those words of God. And you need to have all three. If you took one of those three sort of legs out of the stool would fall over. Without Scripture, we don't have the recorded words of Jesus. Without tradition, we have no Scripture, because Scripture comes to us from tradition. And finally, without the magisterium, everyone is free to interpret however they believe, and we end up with many different versions of Christianity, and that's problematic. Also, we have to keep in mind, like I said, the Bible was written in Hebrew and Greek, and then it was translated into Latin in the year 382 by St. Jerome. and that's the oldest translation that we have in the Bible. There are some versions in English that are direct translations from that version. They're kind of hard to read, though. And then we went into the actual kind of lay of the land of Israel. You have a lot of familiar sounding names, but just to kind of put where they are, you have the Mediterranean Sea. So Israel is on the very eastern shore of the Mediterranean Sea. It is this sort of diamond triangular shaped piece of land right there. It's not very big. The Diocese of Lincoln is bigger than the entire country of Israel. In the north, you have the Sea of Galilee, which is not actually a sea, it's a freshwater lake, connecting to the Dead Sea by the Jordan River. The Dead Sea is also a lake, but it isn't freshwater, it's saltwater, because it has a very high evaporation rate, and that's why it's called the Dead Sea. Nothing can live there. It's far, far saltier than the ocean. And then you basically have Jerusalem in between the north and the south extremities of the country. And for reference, Egypt is down there, and Jordan is right here, and Syria is up here. So those are the bordering nations. We still use the Old Testament because Jesus came to fulfill it. He tells us this, so it's obviously important for us. So we don't revoke the Old Testament. We hold on to it. It's so important. I think one of the major differences between Catholics and other Christians is that Catholics didn't get rid of the entire Old Testament. We still have things like the priesthood and sacrifices. We still have things like the idea of a memorial. We have a Passover meal still. So all of these fulfillments of the Old Testament are very important. So we don't cancel out, we fulfill. I talked about how there were four types of books of the Old Testament. The first type of book is the Law. It's also known as the Torah or the Pentateuch. Pentateuch just means five books in Greek, and it is the first five books of the Bible: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And we stopped our classes last year at the end of the book of Deuteronomy. The second type of book are the history books of the nation of Israel. These are the books that we're going to be talking about today, or at least part of the books. And it goes all the way from them entering into Israel all the way to the destruction and restoration of Jerusalem, which we will eventually talk about. Then there's the wisdom books, which are books like the Psalms, the Song of Solomon, Sirach, Wisdom. They don't really tell a story. They're more books of praise. They tell about the greatness of God. And then the fourth type of book of the Bible, of the Old Testament, makes up the majority of the Old Testament, are the books of prophecy. There are 12 minor prophets and 12 major prophets. The major prophets are called major prophets just because the books are a lot longer than the minor prophets. And their job was to prepare Israel for their Messiah. We will be talking about some of them, not all of them. So, sort of like we did last time, we're going to be following a timeline of history. We're not going to be going through the Bible cover to cover because it's out of order, first of all, and it makes it harder to read and to understand. So we're just going to be going through in a timeline fashion. So we did that. We started with Genesis, beginning with creation and the fall. The fall being the original sin. Adam and Eve lost supernatural life with God. They lost the relationship with each other. They realized they were naked. They mistrusted. They lost the relationship with themselves because their lives now ended in death. And then with the rest of creation, their labor became laborsome. And that's why we have creation sort of going against us now. And we can see immediately Adam and Eve kind of turn on each other and they start blaming each other. And they even blame God. Adam says, "The woman who you gave to be with me made me do it. Made me eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." And so we see immediately there is a barrier between God and a barrier between each of us. So that's the original sin. One of the effects of original sin is concupiscence, which is our inclination to do wrong. and it's caused by original sin. We inherit it because Adam and Eve are our first parents. Just like we inherit all sorts of things from our parents, we inherit original sin from them. Then we got to the patriarchs. The patriarchs are Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph and his brothers. Beginning with Abraham, who God calls, he says, "You will have a nation of you that will number as numerous as the stars." Oh, wow. And so we have the story of Abraham sacrificing Isaac, and we pointed out some of the similarities between that story and the story of Jesus on the cross, where both sons carry the wood for the sacrifice, both fathers offer their beloved son, and both sons submit themselves willingly. Then we have the sons of Isaac, Esau and Jacob. Jacob is the younger son, but going outside of convention of the day, that is the one, that is the son that God chooses to be the descendant of his chosen people. And so Jacob ends up having 12 sons of his own, four from his, well, a lot, okay, so yeah, 12. Rachel has two, Rachel's maid has two, Leah has six, and Leah's maid has two. Then Jacob's sons end up in Egypt because they sell Joseph into slavery. Joseph ends up in Egypt as a slave, but he works his way up to be the advisor to the Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and he has a gift of dreams, and he interprets the Pharaoh's dreams to predict the coming of a famine, and there is a famine. Egypt is the only nation that's prepared for it, and so Joseph allows his brothers to come into Egypt to survive the famine, and that's where they stay. 400 years later, 400 years of slavery later, the Israelites are called by, Moses is called by God to release them from slavery, and God hears their cries of freedom. We all know the stories, we went over it last year, of the 10 plagues. And on the night of the 10th plague, they have the Passover meal. And they prepare the meal in a hurry because they're running away. And that's why we have unleavened bread. They didn't have time for their bread dough to rise. And this is where we get the idea of the Passover meal and eventually the Mass. And they put the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost. So that's another foreshadowing of the blood of Jesus saving us from sin. We know the story, they escape from Egypt, the Red Sea closes in on the Egyptian army, and the Israelites escape into the desert. Moses receives the Ten Commandments, when while he's receiving the Ten Commandments, the people grow impatient, and they make a golden calf. We're going to see this. It will be a problem over and over for the Israelites worshiping foreign gods. And Moses reacts by grinding up the calf, burning it, making the Israelites drink the ashes mixed in with water. And he and the Levites go around and take out the idolaters, saving the people from their apostasy. And as a result, the Levites are made a tribe that is solely dedicated to serving as priests. And the Levites were in charge of basically the law of Israel, carrying it out. And the two results of this confrontation between God and the false gods results in, first, the ritual purity laws, which are also called the kosher laws that Jews follow, that guides their diet, their cleanliness, all sorts of aspects of daily life. And then also the fact that they would now be sacrificing the animals that they had once worshipped in Egypt. And so they have the sacrificial priesthood. And this lasts all the way up until the time of Jesus. Let's talk about that. So where we left off, the Israelites are on the border of the Holy Land. They're waiting to get in. It took them 40 years because they failed to trust in God's power, God's ability to help them defeat their enemies. They were afraid of the people that were living there, and they just didn't trust God. And so it took an entire generation of people to die off to be allowed to enter into the Promised Land. And during that time, they start worshiping the false gods again. And that's a problem. And so that's why it took so long. God had to weed out those people. And so the only people that are left at the end of those 40 years are three people: Moses, Joshua, and Caleb. And Moses does not enter into the Promised Land.